in the place of prayer, you receive revelation. And when that revelation comes, you begin to do according to the precept that was shown you. That's what Jesus said. The miracles that you see me get is because I do what I see my Father do. So in the place of prayer, he is receiving revelation for the work. He writes it down and he comes and do what God shows him to do. Faith without work is dead. Glory does not happen. You prepare for glory. Say, so prepare me a habitation. When God anoints you, the anointing will lead you to preparation. Because without preparation, there will be no glorification.
God has commissioned Apostle Claude Azangisa to spread the fire and presence of the Holy Spirit in the heart of every young person, making Christ the ultimate personality in their life. Get set for a word that will set your heart on fire for God and grant you dominion over the affairs of life. Now, Apostle Claude Azangisa.
Spirit of God, fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come, your will be done here at the
Hallelujah. You know, the ultimate assignment of the Holy Spirit is to represent the image of God the Father here on earth. Is to bring heaven. You see, earth is supposed to mirror heaven. And the only agent, the only agency that has a full understanding of how heaven looks like, of even what heaven is the Holy Spirit. Because I think it's in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2 that says, who knows the mind of the Father? It's only the Spirit of God that knows the mind of the Father, that knows what he has in his mind, that knows how the Father looks like. He's the one that has the full capacity to fully represent that image here on earth. His assignment, the assignment of the Holy Spirit is to help men to mirror God the Father. Because the ultimate agenda of man is to be the earthly representative of God. That's why without the Holy Spirit we are helpless. Without the Holy Spirit, we are helpless. Oh, Shandala.
Oh, Spirit of God, fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Here in heaven, Father, who can take your place, deserve the highest praise. You alone, we give our crown to you. We say you reign, God alone.
Gabriel, give me Colossians chapter 3, from verse 14. Colossians 3, from verse 14. And above all this, let's do from verse 10. From verse 10, and then we come down to 14. Hallelujah. And put on the new man. Hallelujah. Go to verse 9. Mortify. It means put to death. There are things that it is your responsibility. Hallelujah. Amen. Your walk with God is your personal responsibility. You are responsible. You are responsible, which makes judgment possible. If at all you are not responsible for certain things, then God will not have the right to actually judge you. So because he has given you the power to will, and he has given you the ability to choose, it gives him the right to not judge you. If at all God was not the one controlling you, then he lacks the will and the right to judge you. It means that whatever you are doing, he's responsible. But he took that away from himself and allowed you to have your own free will, which now gives him the right to not judge you. So he's not saying, if ye be risen with Christ, seek. Gabriel, just to take me to verse 1. Eh? Okay. If ye be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Question. What are you seeking? Does this scripture reflect your life? The Bible says, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. I like this one. It says, set your affection, your desires. Set your affection. You see, I like the fact that this scripture, it is not in any way saying that God is going to do these things for you. It's a call to be responsible. As God's children, we are called to be responsible. We are called to manually work out our salvation. Salvation is not automatic. When you were born again, the receiving of that salvation was automatic. You were transferred automatically from the kingdom of darkness into his marvelous light. Now that you have not come into the light of God, you have to work it out. So here he's saying, set your affection. Praise the Lord. So you need to examine yourself. Where are your affections? What do you love more than God? Do you love your education more than God? You know, nobody needs to tell you yourself, you know where your affection is. Do you love money more than God? You can tell it's actually easy. Check, look at the activities of your life and see the content thereof. You yourself, you can tell. You can weigh yourself on a balance today and see where your affection really is. Do the things of God excite you? Where is your affection? Do the things of God excite you? Or is it a drag? David said, I was glad when they said, hallelujah. His affection was in the house of God. Praise the Lord. Where is your affection? Where is your affection? Have they set your affection? So meaning you have what it takes to set your affection. You have what it takes. You have what it takes to make up your mind. I made up my mind that I will love Jesus. I made up my mind the house of God will become my number one priority. I made up my mind to love the Lord. I made up my mind to love the brethren. Is a conscious effort. Working with God is a conscious effort. Having a prayer life is a conscious effort. You don't automatically wake up and see yourself praying. It's a conscious effort. In fact, Peter said, we will give ourselves to the ministry of prayer and the word. It was a conscious. They made up their mind that they planned it. They said, this is what we are going to be doing. What have you planned to be doing for God? Have you outlined a prayer life? Have you outlined a lifestyle? Christianity is not a religion, but there is religion in it. It has a religion. It's not a religion. Christianity is not a way of life. It is a life, but it has a way of life. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. you have to set your affection. It says, set your affection. What are the things that you like to watch? When you go to your phone, if you check your YouTube right now, if you check your YouTube history, what are you going to see? If you open your laptop, what are you going to see? Me, if my YouTube opens right now, even if I don't, if my YouTube, you will just see all manner of men when appearing. Now, YouTube now knows me. They suggest these things to me. As you just see me coming on, they'll put men of God there. Because they know. They know the content of my heart. You, when you appear, what do they give you? What do they know that you've been feeding on? When you open your YouTube feed right now, who are you going to be seeing? What are you going to see? What has been your affection? What are the things that you spend your time with the most? To set your affection. So it's a conscious thing. Set your affection on things above. Do you experience this thing before? Let me see if you just lift your hand. Do you normally have an imaginary life where you're walking in the street and you just start imagining? Does it happen to you? And you start imagining yourself having $1 million. And you start imagining exactly. It happens, right? You start imagining yourself what you do. And those kind of walks, they're the most sweetest walk. The distance is no longer long because you're just reminiscing this thing in your heart. Hi. You're seeing yourself in millionaire, you know. You're seeing yourself in your Range Rover villa. Bella, she was said in your house. No. You are setting your affection. I don't know what's the content of your imagination, but can I bring you into mine? So many times when I'm walking in the streets and I'm imagining and I'm so happy. There was this day where I was having this strong imagination and I started weeping in the streets. I was just weeping. I started imagining. I think I thought I was honest. I was imagining myself standing in front of Prophet Emmanuel Makandiwa. And I was telling myself, my goodness, what will I do if I just stand before this man? Hey, my affection is set on this thing. So many times I imagine myself with the mantle of Archbishop Bethany Dahosa. These are my affections. So many times I just imagine that boy. The anointing of God is upon my life and I'm doing wonders for God. These are my imaginations. These are the contents of my heart. Where have you set your heart? The Bible says heaven and earth will pass away. The desire of my heart. All I want is for you to be glorified. That's what I want. I want Jesus to be glorified. Listen, I know that's what you want too, but it has not taken the dominance in your heart yet. It has not become the constant, it has not become the affection of your heart. What this scripture is saying, set your affection on things above. There are things that have been made available unto you in Christ. Power. Glory has been made available unto you. But the Bible says you now set your affection on those things. This is, I think the challenge is that many people don't know the things that have been made available for them in Christ. I mean, I don't want to get to heaven and look down and I now see all that I could have done for God. I now see the advantage that was given unto me and I didn't use it. Has that ever happened to you before? When you went somewhere, and they gave you something, but you were not aware of what they gave you until you left it. Then you came back and said, "Ha!" You know, I heard the story of this man. He entered the plane. Well, I think it was the comedian that was giving the story. So, the guy beside him was eating. They brought him food. He said, "No." They brought the other guy, he was eating. They brought for him, he said, no, he thought it was to be paid. He didn't know that it was free of charge. Until he came down from the flight. And the guy was hungry. But these things were made available. But he was hungry. They brought him this thing. No, I'm fine. Not like he wanted it. But he didn't know that it's free of charge. It's giving unto him. He didn't know. Until he came out on the flight. Then they now told him, did you eat? He said, I couldn't eat. I'm scared because, you know, things in the plane are very expensive. They said, no. It's freely given unto you. The man said, God, I want to go back to the flight. Well, yesterday you can go back. That's what is going to happen to so many people. When they get to heaven, then they realize the power that was vested on them in Christ. The authority, what they could have been. What they could have done. But it's too late. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. There's a law that has been given unto you. But you can only harness these things by affection. But they set your affection on things above. Not on things in the earth. Today, many people have set their affection on earthly things. The Bible says the wise man, he builds upon the sand. But the foolish man, builds upon the sand. But the wise man, he builds on a rock. He sets his affection on a rock. Where are you building your life? Where is your life standing? Listen, if everything about your life, if every result that you plan to get in your life is by human intelligence, if every result that you are planning to achieve in your life, if the kind of life that you want to produce, listen, Pastor Prince, there are certain things in your life that you, when you look back. You know, there was a man in the scripture that the Bible says that after he achieved, he said, see what my strength has begotten me. And God was angry. God killed him. Because there was no glory. There was no glory of God in his achievement. Listen, it's not that God does not want you to use your power. It's not that God does not want you to use your intellectual capacity. But he wants you to yield it to him. That he may breathe upon it. That your intellectual capacity now does not only stand on your strength, but it stands in the glory of God. So when you come out a success from school, you are coming out from the power of the Spirit of the living God. Do you understand? If or not you are going to work, God does not want you to use your ability. It's not that he does not want you to. He wants you to yield your strength to him. So he can breathe upon your strength. So that you will have the consciousness that whatever I am today is by the glory of God. So there will be no flesh. So how many things can you look back in your life and say, this achievement is by the power of God? If at all everything in your life that you've achieved today was gotten by your human strength, then there's no glory in it. Don't live that kind of life. Don't live the kind of life whereby your from since you were born, everything you achieve is by might. Your degree, by might. Your marriage, by might. Children, by might. Everything, by might. Everything. Your might. No, God doesn't want that. I am, who is the scripture, who is the Bible that says, I am who I am today by the power of God. By the grace of God, right? So my life is a product of grace. That's what God wants. If today you are a successful banker, you are not going to look at the fact that it's because of the sleepless night that you study. You are looking at the grace of God. You are looking at the power of God. You can place God. In your achievement, you can trace God. No, it's not a call to laziness of sitting down. Listen, the Bible says that not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything of ourselves. It said our sufficiency is of God. Our sufficiency. The word sufficiency there means it's from the Greek word ikanotis. It means ability. God wants you to function in his ability. There are things that have been made available for you in Christ. There are things that have been made available. So he's telling you, set your affection. Look at this one. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as of ourselves, but our ability. When David stood before Goliath, the strength, the power that he used to bring on Goliath, that ability was of God. So when he was going to testify in the future, he was going to look back and see the glory of God. He had a testimony, he had a chronicle of God that he can present to his children. Where are the testimonies of God that you can give to your children tomorrow? If you pass today, where do we have a chronicle of your life? What would be the content of the chronicles of Silva? The chronicles of Sylvia? What can we read? Right now where you are. Oh, you know, last week Sunday I was so provoked. I was so provoked. Oh my goodness. I was in church and all of a sudden a holy anger sat on me when my pastor was preaching, and then she was I in Christ Mercy last week Sunday? Was I in Christ Mercy last week Sunday? Yeah, I was in Christ Mercy, I guess. But wherever I was, the preacher was preaching. And they were talking about how mighty men of God, Elijah, and I got angry. You know, those things, they happened to me. I didn't plan to get angry. Holy anger, just something else opened in my spirit. And I was like, what? Why is it that if I want to tell somebody about the power of God, about the deeds of God, I will have to refer to a man who lived so many years ago? When the Bible says we are the written epistles of Christ, why is it that if I want to speak to somebody about God being a provider, I have to go back to Elijah? I have to go back to some dude who lived how many years ago? Who didn't even have God living in him? I said, God, no, it's enough. Today, my preaching is going to be the testimonies of God in my life. So I can come to a place and I want to preach about God being a provider. I bring out the chronicles of God's miracles in my life and I begin to edify nations. We are living epistles. Where are the testimonies of God? I said, God, enough is enough. Never again will I go to preach in a crusade. Listen, let me tell you something. As a preacher, I've noticed something. Most of the times when I'm preaching, and I'm opening scriptures about what God did in the life of people in the Bible, it's awesome. But when I begin to testify about the dealings of God in my life, there is an unusual anointing that comes to sit over the atmosphere. Because at this point, I am not just preaching I am not just ministering as somebody who knows something. I am ministering as a witness. Listen, the strength of your message is in the witness of the power. It's in the witness. It's in the spirit of the witness. Let me explain that. I still want to drive you to this place. The strength of your testimony, the strength of your message is in the power of a witness. Who is a witness? A witness is somebody who saw something firsthand. So when he's testifying as somebody who was there. There's a difference between somebody who heard and is telling you and somebody who was there. So if you want to speak to about God, that's what I love to listen to men of God like Baba Adeboye. You listen to men of God like Bishop Oyedepo. When they stand to preach, if you read Bishop Oyedepo's books, why I like to read his book is because of the chronicles of miracles. The man would, every topic he would raise in the book, he would give you evidences of the dealings of God in his life concerning what he's preaching to you about. Today we have a dead generation who only preach about the things that we are written. Where are the miracles of God in your life? Where are they? If all that you can teach people about God is the things that you read of God being in the lives of other people, then you've actually failed. Because the Bible calls us the living epistles. I said, enough is enough. Never again will I go and teach. I'm telling. I said, God, it's time for manifestations. Yeah, it's time. I want to see your hand in my life. It has become a desperate cry. My affection has been channeled to things above. Everything about my life, I want to see a miracle. I want to be able to trace God in everything in my life. And the Bible says all things are possible. Go back to that scripture, please. Set your affection on things above. What has been given to you from above? The Bible says Christ has been made unto us wisdom. Hey. If every achievement that you've gotten in your life is on the strength of the wisdom of this world, then the glory of God is not there. We do not boast in the wisdom of this world. We boast in the power of God. No wonder Paul said, he said, my testimony, instead of my message is not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in the power of God. Our testimony is in the power of God. When you stand as a businesswoman, your testimony is not in how good you are. Your testimony is how you woke up one day and the Holy Ghost breathed upon you and inspiration began to come onto you to produce something. So when you stand now, the testimony of your business is stand on the strength of the wisdom of God. As a businessman, where are the testimonies of God in your life? It's high time we start asking ourselves, if you are to write a chronicle of God in your life, can you write a book? How many pages can you write? How many times can you tell somebody that God showed up? How many encounters of God do you have? How many? If we are to write, if you have been assigned by God to write a book of all the things that He told you, how many can you write? How many things of God? How many teachings of the Spirit of God can you write? I'm not talking about the teachings of God that was shown unto you, that you heard from other people. I'm talking about your personal, the teachings of the Spirit that came from a personal walk with God that you can table down and teach your children. Because we are called living epistles. If you don't have that, then you begin to have to start journeying towards it. When you start on a crusade, when you look at your friends, when you go to work, what's your testimony? Listen, God, listen, let me tell you, from my heart, I'm telling you, listen, this is the true cry of God. I'm giving you the true heartbeat of the Spirit of God. God does not like it when you go and preach to others and you're opening the Bible. He wants your life to be the epistle. He said, let your light, not the light of the scripture. He had to personalize. He said, you have a light. He said, let that light shine before men. So what you're supposed to bring before men is the light of God that has been crystallized in your soul. It's the light of God that you've been able to capture. So when I'm going to my friends at work and I'm preaching to them, I'm not going to preach to them about John 3:16. They will not. The reason why there's argument between Muslim and Christian is the way Jesus cannot have a son. The reason why there's argument is because there's no power. There's no testimony. There's no witness. What changes men is the witness. When you're able to come to them and say, listen, at night, God came to me. And they say, hey, we got. Then you start explaining the story. And you bring out the evidences in your story, and they can see the tangible manifest. They can see something. Ha! Nicodemus said, he said, no man can do these things. Jesus did not go and bring out, open the encyclopedia and Bible and this stuff. Say, let's talk. No. There were tangible manifestations of God in this man's life that people, a Pharisee, a leader of the Pharisees, looked at him and said, no man can do this thing. He said, except God be with him. Today I want to provoke your heart. I want to provoke you to something. I want to provoke it to a heart, to a life of power. It's enough. Boy, listen, what we have, David did have it. The strength upon which David defeated Goliath was in the strength of circumcision. He said, who is this uncircumcised? So it was on the strength of the law that God gave unto Abraham. It's on the strength of the consecration which God gave unto Abraham. The Bible says, we have received a greater glory. This glory, we have received it into earthen vessels. But the excellency and power may be of God. We have received these treasures in earthen vessels. The treasure that has to come upon them. But we have received this living inside of us. Listen, begin to provoke the power of God to make sure that you have miracles every day. Live a life of miracles. Refuse to live an ordinary life. Listen, start practicing miracles. Start taking water and turn it to wine. It might not work the first time. Go and try it again. I told myself, no more. I refuse to live an ordinary life. I refuse to have, but we have received this treasure in earthen vessels. Listen, it didn't say we are going to receive. It said we have received a treasure. What this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God. We have received it in earthen vessels. This vessel is a carrier of an ancient power that the prophet used to have and do signs and wonders. I have received it to live inside me. But what are you doing with it? The only thing that the power of God does is to make you fall. It's a good start. If it can make you fall, it's a good start. The next thing you have to start doing, use it now. After it makes you fall, stand up and say, I'll make somebody else fall. Start from there. Listen, making people fall is not something that only pastors can do. I was making people fall when I was not even yet a pastor. No, I was never an apostle. Start from there. If I thought you don't even have a testimony of anybody falling in your hand alone, start from there. Start from there. Make it intentional. Somebody has to fall. Yeah, start from there. Start from there. Somebody must fall. Tell yourself tomorrow someone has to fall. So go and shake your boss and watch him. You go back home. You said, Labatos Kapala. Lekato. Father, I know what this power can do. It made me fall. If it can make me fall, somebody else can fall. Lord, enough of me falling. I want to see others fall. Say, Lord, put something in my hand. Listen. Let me bring you into my little prayer life. Many times when I pray, I used to pray for this thing. People falling was not just something that I woke up and I saw it was happening. No. I said, Father, when I lay hands on people, I want to see them fall. I said this thing. I set my affection on this thing. My affection. Because I watched on TV, I saw Ben Hill lay hands on people and they fall. I saw Pastor Chris lay hands on people and they fell. I said, wow, this is awesome. So I have this power. I put my affection on this. I put a demand on this. I want to see this happen. And I went out to pray for my friend. And I laid hands on one person and he fell. I was like, I didn't want him to see. I was jumping. But I just composed myself. Like, I'm a real man of God. You know? Yeah, I remember. I ran to my mom. I said, Mommy. I said, Mommy. I was praying for people and they were falling. I was so excited. I ran to my mom. Why? Set your affection on things above. My affection is on seeing the power of God move. That's where you're going to start. I remember one day, I touched somebody. One day, I just looked at somebody. As the person gave me eye contact, she fell. Wow! I said, goodness. I started feeling like a superhero. Yeah! I am. I am God's superhero. I'm a child of God. Where's your affection? What are the things that you want to see? The Bible says, listen, if you don't know, the Bible says, desire spiritual things. It's a desire. God wants you to have that desire. Now, I desire to see blind eyes open. Listen, they won't just happen automatically. You have to desire it. And you need to start learning how to place a demand on the Spirit for that manifestation. So your life will become a chronicle of miracles. So when you're going to preach to, when you're going to preach to somebody, you are not just opening the Bible, but you are bringing the things that God did in your life. Your life has become a witness of the gospel. Your life has become a testimony of the dealings of God, that others can look at your life. Look at Apostle Alex. Which Bible did the woman of Samaria carry to the people of Samaria? And let me ask you, which Bible did she carry? A woman that was not a harlot. She had a spiritual problem where men could not stay. She married and divorced. Married, whether she divorced or the men died, I don't know what happened. But as she married, the marriage would break. 5 times. Had a problem. And she was running away from human beings. She was running away until she encountered Jesus in Samaria. Until she encountered Jesus Christ. And Jesus preached the gospel to her. Jesus brought out the prophetic. Jesus manifested the prophetic to this woman. And this woman, after she was so touched and blessed by Jesus Christ, the Bible says she went in and brought in all the men. My goodness. How can one woman, then the woman then left her water pot and prophesied. Some people today, they will leave their water pots. I don't know what water pot you are actually carrying. I don't know what you are carrying. Listen, the Bible said about Peter, after he encountered Jesus Christ, he left. Listen, the distraction that is taking you away, what your distraction needs to leave you is an encounter. When you encounter God, you on your own, you will leave that thing. There are water pots that you will never leave until you encounter Jesus. See, and the woman then left her water pot. Kabbalah. Hey! The Lord Jesus will divert your course. I don't know where you are going, but you will have an encounter that will divert your course. I prophesy this to somebody. There will be an encounter of the Spirit that will divert your course. The Bible says you will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. The reason you are trying to change, you are trying to move from one place, you are trying to move in the ways of God, and you are trying and it's not happening, is because you've not yet had an encounter. When Peter encountered Jesus, she left. There are habits that will automatically live on their own when you encounter him. That busy schedule that you feel like you can't do without it. Until you see a glory that is more magnificent than that career. Imagine, a man immersed the whole world. A man was, in one night, he became a supplier. He became an international fish supplier. From nothing to a mighty supplier, but left it all. There's a beauty you will see. It will make you to leave it all. The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and said to the men, come see a man which told me all things that I ever did. Is not this the Christ? Listen, she was not bringing out a scripture. She brought out her encounter with Jesus Christ. It was the testimony of her encounter that she brought to other people, that was able to draw all men to Jesus Christ. I prophesy into your life. You will come into an encounter that will draw nations to God. You will have an encounter that when you go back to work, you will tell your boss and they will kneel and say, show me this Jesus Christ. You will have an encounter that you will come, that you will carry back to your family and everybody will follow you. Begin to have strong burden for this encounter. Where are the testimonies of God in your life? Please go back there. The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and said to the man, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did is not this the Christ. Then they went, listen, Samaria was not a holy land. He says, then they went out of the city and came unto him. Hey, what brought them? The testimony of one woman. She didn't open Bible. You are coming into this place where your life will become a Bible. When I call Apostle Alex walking Bible, I don't mean a man who memorized scripture. I mean a man whose life is a reflection of the scripture. They will call it a walking Bible. They will say your life is a reflection of scripture.
Go back to Colossians chapter 1, chapter 3.
Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, hey, listen, what's your life? Who is your life now? Christ is your life. Christ is my life. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye appear with him in glory. He said, but see what you have to do. He said, mortify therefore your members. Your members means your body. It means your body parts. Mortify therefore your body parts which are upon the earth. What's the first thing that you have to mortify? Fornication. Fornication. It's really not funny. Fornication. Fornication. What is fornication? I don't think I have to explain that because you all know. Listen, let me tell you. If you are here, you are struggling with fornication. Two things are involved. Fornication is habitual, and two is demonic. When you constantly give yourself to this act, a demon will not take over and possess you, and you will now have a demonic spirit whereby your desires are controlled and ruled by a spirit. It forces you to now live that life at will, at his own will. But as a child of God, you have authority. You have the power to choose never to fornicate. Say, I live above fornication. Say with me, I live above fornication. No, don't start saying me, I don't fornicate, so I don't have to say it. I live above fornication. Yeah. Listen. The ultimate way to overcome fornication is not by praying fornication die. No. It's by acknowledging the communication of your faith becomes effectual. But the acknowledging, when you begin to acknowledge who you are in him, the lower you begin to give way. You overcome it by acknowledging who you are in Christ. I'm a child of God. This life has no place in me. This weakness has no place in me. Christ is my strength. My life is hid in God in Christ. In him I live and have my in him I live and move and have my being. When you begin to acknowledge those things, fornication will begin to lose the strength over you. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. Fornication. Uncleanliness. Inordinate affection. What's the meaning of this one? Evil concupiscence. You know what I mean? And that means killing off. Killing off. You kill it. When this desire comes, you kill it. Hold on. Hold this scripture for me. Can I teach you how to deal with fornication? Okay, let's forget about fornication. Let me not mention fornication. Can I teach you how to deal with the flesh? It's very easy. There's a mystery behind dealing with the flesh. I've proved it several times. If you can master this, the answer is in James chapter 3. Give it, take me to James chapter 3.
I put you in front.
James 3. We'll come back here. Watch this. My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. For look at this. Watch here. I will show you how to deal with your body. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, where does it start? Word. I feel very horny. You are very sexy. When you begin to say those things, you are programming your affection. Your language plays a great role in altering your affection. Your language. For in many things you offend all. If a man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man. And able also to bridle the whole body. Meaning the direction of the body can be bridled through the tongue. Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us. And we turn about their whole body. Behold also the sheep, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet they are turned about with a very small helm. Whatsoever the governor listed, even so the tongue is a little member and boasted great things. Have you seen that? He said, a sheep, no matter how big the sheep is, and no matter what, no matter the harshness of the wind that it's exposed to, he said, it is controlled by a small helm. He said, so is the tongue. He said, the way you put bits in a horse's mouth and you're able to control them, that's how the tongue is. So how do you control your affection? By talking. You don't fight your sexual affection with your thoughts. You have to vocalize it. You say, buddy, calm down. When that feeling begins to heat up, don't allow your mind. The reason why it is heating up is because your mind has already failed you. So don't try to use the mind again. Use the tongue. Speak to the body. The body, in the name of Jesus, I bring you under subjection. Kala asogre andala bahaya. If you are lying down, stand up. Don't stay there on the bed. I bring you under subjection. Before you know, your hand will start failing you. So when you say, I bring you, you stand up. You stand up. You get up. You take a walk. If it takes you going to have a cold bath, go have a cold bath. And say, I bring down the temperature of these emotions. Put cold water. Don't put hot water to make matters worse. Because you're already hot. Work out your salvation. There are physical steps. You clear your mind. If your own talking is not working, call a brother. Call Apostle Alex. Huh? Thank God, I have a close relationship with Apostle Alex, so I can just talk there and we start talking. Before I know it, he starts bringing a revelation that will just hit that thing. It will kill it immediately. And we're talking about the scripture. That thing just dies. You don't, all your friends are carnal. You are battling with carnality. And you now go and face a foolish friend that starts telling you that will not put fire on the thing that you're trying to fight. And you go back home carrying bubble. Say, Lord God, what do I do now? Say, Lord, you know what? Let's just give in today. Let's just do it today. Tomorrow, God is merciful. You know. Yeah, the Lord is merciful. Hey! You talk. Learn to talk. Talk to your body. Talk to yourself. You say, I'm the right. You say, sometimes I have to shout it. Sometimes I shout. Hey! Talabashata. I am the righteousness of God. The anointing is in my life. I'm anointed. I refuse to give vent to these emotions. I refuse to give vent. I talk it, talk it, talk. I don't think it. The fact that it has already come to this point, it means that your thinking has already failed you. So now use the tongue. And that means, go back to verse 4. Are we still here? Verse 4, please. Message. Colossians. Verse 4. Message. Laha so great. When Christ, your real life, remember, shows up again on this earth, you'll show up to the real you, the glorious you. Meanwhile, the content, be content with obscurity like Christ. Verse 5. And that means killing off everything connected with the way of death. Brother, there are some things that are connected with the way of death. There is a conversation that is connected with the way of death. God says, kill it. When somebody is bringing the way of death to you, kill it. Cut it off. Who remembers that message? Cut it off. Or what? Or it cuts you off. You guys are old members of our week. Cut it off. Or it cuts you off. Something. And that means killing off everything connected with the way of death. There are friends that they are connected with the way of death. Cut them off. There are people that are connected with the way of death. Cut them off. There are movies that are connected with the way of death. Cut it off. Don't watch it. You know that anytime you meet with this friend, you are going back home carnal. Cut that friend off. You know, some things are very sad, Pastor Gloria. Within our ministry, hardly, you see two members that are walking in the street talking about God. It's rare to find in this ministry. You just see two members charging themselves in the spirit or even praying. Every prayer meeting in this ministry is what I call for. If I did not call for any prayer meeting, nobody will be calling. Nobody prays except I call for it. All the prayer that you've been praying is because the man has not called for it. Where are the ones that you call for? In this ministry, hardly. Even you go for choir practice, hardly. You see choir members sitting down when the rehearsal has already started. You won't see them discussing, my God, last night I was reading this scripture and sharing. No, in this ministry, no. As they sit down, carnality, as they open your mouth, it's foolishness. Start coming out. But things are changing. Yeah. You know, I was so provoked. I think I was with Apostle and his fiance in my car. Oh, my heart bled. Him and his fiance don't know. Because I was complaining. I complained till I dropped them off. I complained all the way. I met with one of my brothers. I said, guy, where are you going? He said, oh, we are going to one of our brother's friends, our brother's house. A brother in the ministry. We are going to our brother's house. I said, ah, what's happening there? He said, ah, it's weekend, so we're just going to go and chill and play a game and talk and have fun.
I said, that's right. Until I entered the car, I said, brethren are coming to meet in one house. To do what? To play games and eat and talk and go back home. Makatala Bashanda. Hey! Gabriel, show me one scripture. Show me Hebrews 10, I think 25. You start practicing when some of you apostles, it's not even foul. As we close fellowship, as you're going back home, nobody is discussing about what happened in the meeting. You will hear topics of nonsense until they forgot everything that the man of God said. You ask them, what did you learn today? It's well. So, as I was saying, tomorrow, that day. You know, let me tell you. So many times, okay, I don't know if I should say this. So many times, after a message is being shared, I have to go and wait for people. I know you're watching them. Nobody brings up, even if you go to our web page, you will not hear anybody say, today's message was just blessed. Let's share. Nobody is sharing anything. Most of the time, I actually wait for them on their status. I'll be watching. To see who will say, who even at least reference something in the message. Nothing. From the message to their status, you are seeing something complete. Because listen, your status is the reflection of your thoughts. So people's status are the content of their mind. So the reason why I go and wait for you on your status is because I want, okay. Now they are going to block me now. I already see the mute the mouth of God. They are going to mute me now. It is my, now I know. Oh, can I mute me? You won't mute Apostle Alex. I'll take his phone. Or you mute me, mute my wife, because I'm going to check her phone. So they'll mute all the pastors of the ministry. Hey! Carnality! Carnal people don't like spiritual people at all. Listen, not forsaking our meeting together as believers for worship and instruction, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more faithfully as you see the day of Christ's return approaching. It means God wants us to be having fellowship, not only as a general body, with one another. The Bible, I don't know which exact scripture it is, but I think it's in the book of Psalm 119. Don't say that. They that help me. Malachi, is it Malachi 4? It says that they that fear the Lord and thought upon his name, right? They speak often one to another, and the Lord heard. And a book of remembrance. Malachi 3:16. Look at it. And they that fear the Lord speak often one to another. Hey! They speak often. You, what are your conversations with your friends? What do you guys talk about? When you meet, what do you guys talk about? When you're walking back home, what do you guys talk about? What's the content of your, when you meet with them, Sarah, your friends, what do you guys talk about? About the new hairstyle, the wig, the food, gloss pastry, the wedding is coming. Hey, which color? Which clothes? 5 hours. What do you guys talk about? How about, my goodness? This is what the Lord spoke to me about yesterday. As you are coming, that's why I love my friend Pastor Rene. As we meet, but we can walk from here to Badu. We are talking about what God, what we got.
This is the kind of relationship that God recommends you to have. He says, they that fear the Lord, speak often one to another. Often. Listen, what are your friends? When you meet with Simeon, what did they talk about? Music, from morning to night. When you meet with Meso. Huh? Sylvia. Tell your friends, what did they talk about? Esther. See why? When you sit in prayer, what do you just talk about? What's the next food I will cook? Do you like curry? Is curry okay? You put Maggi. From morning to night, Maggi and curry, curry and Maggi. Hey! Elisa Bendu. When you sit down with Aquila. Hey! And Sia. And Dobby. When you guys sit down. What kind of fellowship do you have? Hey! And as the Holy Ghost is there, just looking at two of you, looking at all of you. Victor, where is he? Pastor Joel, Victor and David, when you guys meet, you argue about all the political things in the world, from Putin, Vladimir, to, I don't know, to Adam Abaro, to Jame Musa. What do you get? What's the context? Which spiritual mystery? What do you guys talk about? What do you guys talk about? What's the content of your conversation? What do you guys talk about? Hey! The Bible says, they that fear the Lord. Listen, talking about God is the sign that you fear Him. Maria! Last time I saw her and Stephen, they're two. You see, I'm telling you. Like you see them, they're walking in majestic kind. What are they talking about? What do you mean? What did they talk about? As last time I saw you guys at Post Office, you were talking like somebody was talking to a boyfriend. What are you guys talking about? What? Hey! My goodness. Abraham. If you go to MC, you see Abraham.
Hey.
My goodness. Hey! They that fear the Lord. My goodness. Abraham. Abraham. When you and beloved meet, what do you guys talk about? Appreciating beauty. You're not appreciating your beauty. They that fear the Lord. Hey! You see, the reason why there's no power in the church is because nobody has a testimony anymore. It's not that they don't want to talk about God. It's that they don't have anything to say. That's the problem. Their mouths are not full with the wonders of God. Their hearts are not closed to God. Yeah. Start practicing it. You see, you start losing friends. This is the only Bible. When you come around, the only Bible. Listen, start practicing it. Make up your mind. If it's not Bible, you won't talk. Yeah. Don't talk. Sam, last night. Oh, yesterday, I was reading a scripture. Listen, the Bible says the body grows by which every joint supplies. What are you supplying? If the only joint that is supplying to the body is the man of God, there's a problem. What are you supplying to the body? When you go and meet your friends, Victor, when you meet your friends, what do you guys talk about? What do you guys talk? What do you guys discuss? Is it edifying? We have to start edifying each other because we see the day approaching. So we change our conversation. Everybody is coming with the witness of God, with the testimony. He had an encounter last night. He wants to share with his friends. They that fear the Lord, speak often. Why is it that the only place where we talk about God is in church? Why? This thing we should carry it over back home. Where did I learn how to preach? I did not learn how to preach by here.
I learned it from talking with my friends. The first time I preached to was Pastor Rene. I would preach to him, he would preach to me. I preach to him, he preach. We'll spend fire for hours.
Listen, let me tell you one secret. My best messages that I preach, you know where I got them from? From my me and my wife, our Bible study. Anytime I wake up to pray with my wife, by 5 a.m., when we wake up to pray, first of all, I like to share the word with her. As I open, the kind of revelation that I used to pull out from our family altar, it used to shock me. It's something that I used to draw out and come and minister here, most of the time. Listen, there are certain revelations of God that has been programmed in your preaching. Wait, hold on. There are certain revelations of God that have been programmed in your preaching to others. There are certain, you will begin to realize that as you are talking to somebody, a certain revelation will open up to you and you start preaching something you never studied. God starts teaching you right there and you come out with a revelation, you go back home to go and study what you are preaching to somebody else. Most of my highest revelations, they came from my place of preaching in the street to other people, my conversations with my friends. For he that watches, the watering of the spirit comes from your watering order. So you starve yourself of the ministry of the spirit when you are not ministering to others. God has given you a platform to minister. So every time you meet with your friend, it's a platform God is giving you. Anytime you meet with somebody, it's a platform. So when you go back to work tomorrow, you have a platform. You say, break time, take your friend out. Say, let's go have lunch. He said, what do you think about John 3:16? Don't tell me I'm personally with that. He said, boy, I saw this scripture last night. And he starts talking. Tell them, what do you think about John 3:8? Boy, let me show you what God showed me in John 3:8. And as you start talking, the next day they also be challenging. They also want to share with you. Change your conversation. Hey, I foresee a very lonely walk with people. See, two members that they walk like this. Nobody has any spiritual people. Walking back home, nobody is talking. Because nothing is coming out. You see them walking. Man of God, we should preach God's follow. Let me run now. They that fear the Lord speak often one to another. And the Lord has it. It means that every time we are discussing about God, He comes to hearken. He comes to listen. Let me give you a mystery. Do you know that many times when we are saying the word, angels come to listen? Do you know why they come to listen? Because God has programmed that the gospel will be ministered unto them through us. They come to learn of God through us. So we are the ones that show them God. They see God, but they don't know Him. So they learn of God through us. This mystery, which was hidden in ages past, and now is made manifest to the saints, not the angels. So the mystery of God is revealed to only the saints. Angels don't know the gospel. That's why the angel that appeared to Cornelius could not preach the gospel to Cornelius. He told Cornelius, go and look for Simon Peter. He will tell you. Because the angel had no revelation of the gospel. It's Peter who had it. Then those that fear the Lord speak with each other. And the Lord listens. Hey, every time you are having conversation, God comes to listen. The Lord listens to what they said in His presence. A scroll. Those who fear the Lord spoke with each other, and the Lord listened to what they said. In His presence, a scroll of remembrance was written to record the names of those who feared Him and always thought about the honor of His name. Hey, there is a reward in heaven for those people who always preach about God. God is, when you go back to school, what are you going to be discussing with your friends? Let's finish this. And then we pray. And that means killing off everything connected with the way of death. I said there are friends who are connected with the way of death. Meaning each time you meet them and you guys start talking, your spirit man dies. Have you met people after talking with them? Your spirit is missing. When Pastor Rock came, when many of the brethren came to visit him, some left the house crying. Some like, oh my God, Pastor Rock came just for me. As you meet with him and you guys start talking, revelation upon revelation. When you sit down with him, what's the content of your conversation? Who are the people that you meet? Do they give you spiritual life or they bring death to you? Maybe they would discuss politics until, boy, you become confused. You go back home with the confusion. You go back home angry. When people leave you, what happens to them? When people come in contact with you, what do they contact? I love the story of Elizabeth. When she came in contact with Mary, she said, the baby in my womb leaped up. Hi, what happens to people when they come in contact with you? When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, listen, I'm praying to God for this dimension. Whereby I will be so much endowed with God that when people even hear my voice, they will begin to leap. Go back to this Colossians, tell that Colossians. Thank you so much, sir. And that means killing off everything connected to the way of death. Sexual promiscuity, impurity, lust, doing whatever you feel like, whenever you feel like it, and grabbing whatever attracts your fancy. That's a life shaped by things and feelings instead of by God. It's because of this kind of thing that God is about to explode in anger. Hey, have you read the scripture that these are the children of wrath? There are those who are the children appointed to wrath. It means, this is what this guy was telling John. He said, who has warned you of the wrath to come? There is a day where God is going to explode in anger. And that day is coming very soon. Because the rapture has been set. When the rapture takes place, God is going to explode in anger. A man of God said something. He said, listen, all this plague that you are seeing, he said, it's like we have gone back to the days when the church, you see, we are in the days of Exodus. We are in the days of Exodus. What was the day of Exodus? It was when Israel were about, because there was a set time by God where Israel was supposed to leave Egypt. They were going to rapture. He was going to carry them on eagle wings out of Egypt. And the Israel of God is about to leave Egypt from this world. But how did it happen? It happened by God slapping Egypt 10 times. Listen, it was not God's desire to slap Egypt 10 times. Each time God was slapping Egypt, the first place, is because God is giving them room to repent, to amend their ways. So we are seeing all the plagues are hitting us. Global warming, COVID-19. Things are warming up because there's a great exodus that's about to take place. And when that happens, the wrath of God will explode. You don't want to be here. When God is going to explode his wrath. For we think's sake, the wrath of God come on the children of disobedience. And hold on. Look at it. Sorry. But we think the wrath of God coming on the children of what? Listen, it did not say the unbelievers. It means the children of what? It means that it's even talking about Christians who do not live in alignment with the word of God. Who do not live in alignment with the Spirit. Who walk in disobedience. Next week Sunday, you don't have to miss next week Sunday. And next week Sunday, our fellowship is not going to be here. It's going to be at Shalom Cafe at Senegambia. It's going to be really big. So don't dress casually. Some of you, the way you even dress to come to fellowship is a bit appalling. You dress like you are going to bed. You wear one slipper and just roll in. No. You're coming to the fellowship of the brethren. Dress well. You're coming to the fellowship of kings. Don't dress like you're coming. If you're going to meet Barak, will you dress like this? If Barak called you in an appointment in office, you wouldn't dress this way. You would dress well. Next week, dress properly and come. Okay? Let's look at it. For which sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in the which you walk sometimes when you live in them. Some of you are still living there. But now, he also put off all this anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one for another, seeing that you have put off the old man with you. Please break in message, please. Message. Put off. But you know better now. So make sure it's all gone for good. Bad temper. Tell us about bad temper. Bad temper. Bad temper. Some of you bragging it. I get what I'm at. No! Don't brag in those things. And if I get angry, you won't like me. No! Have to put it off. Badat. Wamat. All these things, put it off. Refuse to identify with that spirit. You are in nature of love. You are a being of love. Bad temper, irritability, meanness, profanity. I like this one. Dirty talk. Don't lie to one another. You are done with that old life. It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes. You strip off and put on it and put in the fire. Now you are dressed in a new wardrobe. Every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator, with his label on it. What the ladder is custom made by the Creator with his label. We don't brag with the label of Dolce and Gabbana. We have the label of the Creator, the label of Christ. We don't brag with Gucci. We brag with Christ, not with Gucci. We have a new label. We are not dressed in Gucci. We are dressed in Christ. Every item of your new life is custom made by the Creator with his label on it. And the old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religion, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized and occult, slave and free, mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ. You know what that means? It means that Christ has removed the barrier. He has broken the what? The middle wall of what? Of partition. And he has called in everybody. So everybody now has the right to Christ. Okay? So choose by God. So chosen by God for this new life of love. Have you seen that? It's a life of what? It's a life of love. Dress in the wardrobe. In the wardrobe God picked out for you. So what is the dress that you're supposed to wear? One is what? Compassion. Say with compassion. So when you're going to work tomorrow, don't just wear your necktie. Wear compassion. You know what that means? To be compassionate, it means to be felt with the feeling of people's infirmity. You're not going in the street and seeing the beggar and saying, compassion. You're going to be very nice. You're going to greet people. Some of you don't greet people. It's a sign of pride. You will greet people nicely. When you greet people, greet them with love. Not hello, Maria. No compassion. T.Y. Yeah, God bless you. No. Hello, T.Y. God bless you. Well, good to see you. Nice hair. God bless you. Hello, you are. No. Compassion. Not when you're not sitting where you do. Hello, Apostle. You're lying. Nobody's talking. It's just you there. Unless you pass. Or you see how those of you who are laughing, you're all guilty. Compassion. Kindness. Hey, you'll be kind. Right? You'll be kind. Pastor Joel, when I ask you to borrow me money, you'll be kind. Kindness. Okay, now I don't say, now go to people now and say, please, be kind.
Be kind.
No, I did not send you on any errand. Victor, stop looking at him. He says, be kind. Humility. Hey, look at the name and say humility. This one is very important. You are going, as you're going to work tomorrow, you are going to say this to yourself. As you wear your clothes, the compassion, humility, kindness, you're wearing this thing. Quiet strength. What does this mean? What does this mean? Quiet strength. You know what this means? Can I explain that to you? It means that you have the power to slap this person, but you give it up. You have the strength to talk back, but you give it up. Because a new man does not always want to show himself. He's hidden in Christ. So chosen by the God for this new life of love, dressed in the words of God speak out for you, compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength, discipline. Say discipline. Discipline. Be even tempered. Content with second place. I don't know what that means. What does it mean? What does it mean? Second wife?
No.
No. Please give me King James this verse. Let me see what King James says. This man wants to confuse me. Forbearing one another and forgiving one another. Hey. So this is what you're going to wear. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Forgiving one another. It's a conscious effort. Listen, if you want to rapture, you have to make up your heart. Are you hearing it? Make up your mind to forgive. Forgiving. Make allowance for others' fault. Yeah. No, this is too much. Victor, have you seen that? God is saying, make allowance. He knows that this person is not perfect. So God is not telling you, you know what? Make allowance. Ahead of time. Ahead of time. That is, forgive him ahead of time. Forgive her ahead of time. So you have to know that this guy is not perfect. So you are making allowance. If you have that mindset, when people flaw, you won't be too hard. Because you already made allowance in your heart. And alongside, you begin to pray for them. Each time somebody is offending you, is God giving you room to pray for them? Make allowance for each other's fault and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Praise the Lord. Continue. And regardless of what you put on, I like this one. Regardless of what you put on, wear love. It's your basic, all-purpose garment. Never be without it. Say, I put on love. I walk in love. Listen, you want to express the power of God? This is the message for you. Continue, sir. Let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. None of this going off and doing of your own thing. And cultivate thankfulness. Can you just look at two people and go and tell them thank you? Just say thank you to two people. Okay, now go to somebody who deserves your thank you. If there's somebody who deserves your thank you, go to them and just say thank you. Hi. Sir Jerry and his wife, they are telling each other 50 thank yous right now. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Look at somebody else.
Thank you.
Your spouse is not the only person.
Thank you so much.
Let me say thank you. Thank you. Thank somebody. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Abraham. Thank you. Thank you, Doris. Thank you. Hey, thank you, Apostle Alex. Thank you. Let the word of Christ, the message, have the run of the house. Give it plenty of room in your lives. Instruct and direct one another using good common sense. And sing. Sing your heart out to God. Let every detail in your life, word, action, whatever, be done in the name of the Master. Jesus, thanking God the Father every step of the way. Please quickly. Thank you. Give a thank you. Wives, understand and support upcoming wives. Wives and upcoming wives. We have an upcoming wife in this place. She's already upcoming. Upcoming wife. Wives, said I hear it. Marriage counseling. This is marriage counseling for you. You pay extra for this one. Why? Mr. Takimbogu. Why? Understand and support your husband. How do you do it? By submitting to them in ways that honor the master. Have you seen that? Husband, Apostle Alex, this is marriage counseling class for you. Sir Jeremiah, are you hearing this one? Blair, are you hearing this? Oh, sorry. I am prophesying. Husband, go all out. Hey, Apostle, have you seen this one?
Yes, sir.
Victor, don't be a husband if you don't do this one. You try. He says, go, not some, all out. Go all out in love for your wife. Don't take advantage of them. Oh. Please, can somebody help us? How do men take advantage of their wife? How does a man take advantage of his wife? By waiting for her to come and say sorry. No, it's the man that always has to go after her. No matter what happens. Even if she's wrong, you have to go after her. Oh, Vic, you don't like this one, Abby? Somebody say, man of God, please. Don't preach this kind of gospel here. You are going to give the woman's wings. Listen.
Don't shadow you won't light up. Mountain you won't climb up.
What? Who is the one coming after you? The husband, right? Never take advantage of her. How else do you take advantage of her? When you raise your voice. How else do you take advantage? Huh? When you expect her to cook every day. Cook at what time? And what are you cooking?
Fufu.
A woman will come and pound fufu by 4 a.m. for you. Say, I'm the husband. After pounding fufu, say, go and cook on her for me. Or is it on her? Go and cook on her. And bring fresh juice. Not on time. I'm going to look for juice and come and grind it for you. Victor, this is for you. Husband, go all out. Go on, Jeremiah. All out. All out.
Listen, having a wife has humbled my life. You will not know how marriage, God uses mine to discipline you as a man. When God wants to break your ego, He allows you to get married. And He begins to teach you His word. So no matter what happens, go all out. Even when you don't feel like it, you don't want to, you have to go all out to make her happy. Sylvia, go all what? Make her happy. Go all out. If it takes stealing, go and steal to buy her clothes. I'm joking. But go all out. Are you here? No, you're not here. Husbands, go all out in love for your wife. Don't take advantage of them. Children, do what your parents tell you. This delight the master. This delight the master no end. Parents, don't come down too hard on your children, or you'll crush their spirits. Some of you need to go and show your parents this thing. I can see somebody writing this picture. I can see somebody writing this picture. Somebody is screenshotting right now. Parents, don't come down too hard on your children, or you'll crush their spirit. Servants, do what you are told by your earthly master, and don't just do the minimum that will get you by. Do your best. When you're going back to serve your boss tomorrow at work, your best. Servants, do what you are told by your earthly master, and don't just do the minimum that will get you by. Do your best. Work from the heart for your real master, for God. Confident that you'll get paid in full when you come into your inheritance. Keep in mind always that the ultimate master you are serving is Christ. The solemn servant who does shoddy work will be held responsible. Being Christian doesn't cover up bad work. Wait, hold on. We need to do that again. Gabriel, right? Being Christian. You know, somebody said we should support our brothers who are doing music. If a Christian musician is not singing well, we'll not support you. Yeah. I won't support you because you are Christian. Yeah. I will support you because you are excellent. The reason why today we have a homosexual that is kissing on public, becoming a ruler in America, is because Christians are not doing good work. If a Christian qualifies for that role, they will give it to him. Maybe there's not a Christian who qualifies properly, but you know their agenda. Gabriel, you people with your agenda. Gabriel and his people, their agenda. The solemn servant who does shoddy work. I like this one. Gabriel, are you saying this? Meaning we don't do shoddy work. Don't do shoddy work. The solemn servant who does shoddy work will be held responsible. Being Christian doesn't cover up bad work. And master, treat your servants considerately. Be fair with them. Don't forget to minute that you too serve a master, God in heaven. Please, let's end it here. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Just bow your head in prayer. Were you blessed today? Just begin to bow your head in prayer and begin to say words, speak words to God. Just speak words to him.
There is nothing you cannot do. Nothing's too hard for you. There is nothing you cannot do. Jesus. Oh, there is nothing you cannot do. Oh, nothing's too hard for you. There is nothing you cannot do. Jesus. Jesus.
Dear saints of God, we believe this message has been a blessing to your soul. Please to share your testimony with us. Contact us on +220 3199330 or 3064155 or 3321694. You can also send us an email at actofchange1@gmail.com or follow us on Facebook at Act of Change. Act of Change Ministry, changing lives, transforming nations.